today I'm going to talk about backward stochastic differential equations, which is abbreviated as BSDE. So my actual goal is not actually about stochastic calculus, but about the connections between stochastic calculus and PDE. So let me get started on the connections between those two, which are quite well known. Or if you are not in analysis, but you can learn some right now. So, first part is connections between PDE and stochastic. Okay. So, if Ian comes here, and he was teaching on PDE, the first thing that we learned is the mean value problem. Which is abbreviated as MEP. Well, good name. So it says that a function U satisfies the mean value property if you look at a core centered at x with radius r, and you take the average of the function, it happens that you get the value of the function at the center. Okay. So if you take some derivatives, this is equivalent to, if you take the average, instead of over the ball, but over the sphere, to get the function no value at the center as well. Still, there's no PDEs. But if you assume that you can take second order derivative, this is equivalent to the Laplacian of the U is equal to zero. So let's say on the entire real space, I don't want to talk about boundaries. Okay, so this is the mean value properties with PDE, which corresponds to this Laplace equation or Poisson's equation. Something very well known to a function satisfies the mean value property is that you have a stochastic correspondence, namely the Brownian motion. So let's say WT. W stands for Vena, which just is the guy who defined Brownian motion rigorously. Anyway, it's a Brownian motion. This is a martingale, and if U satisfies the mean value property, you actually have that not only that W itself is a martingale, but U acting on W this process is also a martingale. At least when you look at this process on a really large disk. That's great with martingale. And why is that? Because of two things. First is that martingale, well, is actually an average equal to itself. So the definition of a martingale is saying that you have a process previous time. It so happens that the conditional expectation is the process at the previous time. So expectation is an average, and it equals to the process, the value of the process at a previous time. But somehow like limits this like average is equal to the function itself, the condition. Okay. So Martingale takes an average, that's one thing. And the other thing is that here, let's suppose that U is smooth. Want to take as many derivatives as you like. So recall Eaton's formula. look at the differential, the change of the process UWT is given by, well, you have a fundamental theorem of calculus term, which is given by gradient of U. But because the process is so irregular, that heuristically, this differential, dWt, is of order t1 over half. So because of like the roughness of the path, and when you do Taylor expansion, we'll pick up the first order term by looking at the second order of dWt. So and the second order term of the Brownian motion, which is the first order term of the time, because the differential of Brownian motion is of order 1 half. So this guy is actually first order of time. So you pick up this extra term of first order of time, but the mean value property, the PDE of the mean value property, tells you that, well, yes, in general we will have this extra term, but because the Laplacian vanish over the entire space, so this first order term of time is actually zero. So the change of the new process UWT, it just looks like WT itself, which is a modular, because this one on average, the expectation does not change. So that's the, I would say, the first basic connections between PDE and stochastic calculus is that now you have a connection between the mean value property or harmonic function and Martingales and the transformation of Brownian motion, which happens to be Martingale. So, my intention of doing this is I first introduce like, the Eaton's formula, recall the Eaton's formula. And then,
so,
yes.
If you have a martingale, continuous martingale, could you cook up something to make it like a Laplacian to be zero?
Not Laplacian, but some other operators. Some other thing.
Like, yeah, some variance of Laplacian of second order.
Mm-hmm.
Or some metric, maybe.
I don't know. So, basically, it depends on how your martingale looks like. Because, right, here's a fact is that if you have a continuous martingale, you can always write it as, let's say, continuous martingale, you can write as a P as a some stochastic integration of a Brownian motion. So what you would do is that eventually you pick up something like this in your operator instead of a Lagrangian. Because here, in the simplest case of Brownian motion, this integrand is actually the identity matrix. So which you get Lagrangian. So in general, for general Martingale, you pick up some extra terms which puts your differential operators. Okay. Okay. Just one connections between stochastic calculus and PDEs. And now let me give you another connection, which is quite deep. So it says that elliptic or parabolic PDEs, they are actually just nothing but a stochastic process. So let me tell you what an elliptic equation is. So say you have this operator U, L, acting on function U. Given by is half times a matrix Aij and summing over all the I's and j's over this partial second order partial differentials of U plus summing over all the I's Ei acting on the partial derivatives. So in matrix notation, this is just D times gradient U, and this is just a half times matrix A. And you look at the Frobenius inner product of matrices. Okay. So let's say you have this operator, differential operator. A is, for simplicity, let's say it's symmetric. And positive definite. Okay. And such an operator can be viewed as a stochastic process. Okay. Why is that? Because, oh, by the way, this means that the operator L is elliptic. Because like elliptic, you can think of it, it's generated by a matrix that's positive definite. Okay. Now you have an elliptic operator. When you look at this PDE, I was thinking that this can be think of as a stochastic process. Because people conjecture that U of x is given by an integration of the kernel. In space. Then this kernel G, boundary data. So instead of looking at on the entire space, I look at the equation on bounded Lipschitz domain. You can conjecture that the solution to PDE is actually D given by an integration of this form, where this G is called a kernel. Okay, so this G of X, you can think of it as the probability of a stochastic process X of T, where X starts at X and ends at Y, where Y is on the boundary. So indeed, this is saying that G of X of Y is the probability density of X, then in X is the domain omega at the point Y, which is on the boundary. It's given by this probability. Okay, I haven't tell you how to generate this process X. I'm just telling you that there's a magic process X. The X is indeed generated by this operator L. So the dynamics of X is that you start at this little X, and then you flow this stochastic process according to this differential equation, stochastic differential equation. With a drift B, depending on the time and position. And a diffusion matrix sigma, which depends on the current time and position as well. And the diffusion term is driven by a Brownian motion. And you choose this sigma such that sigma times its transpose is a matrix A. You can always do that because I assume that A is symmetric and positive definite. So it's like a matrix times its transpose, you can think of it as a matrix square. And positive definiteness allows that you can do this thing, since that there is such a sigma. Okay, this is our conjecture, so let's verify that. Again, we will use Nihon's lemma. So let's do this now. Define a function v of tx defined to be the expectation of a function acting on the position that the process hits the boundary or access the boundary. And the expectation is conditioned on the process. Process starts at the position x. So because look at this differential equation, the future dynamics of this process, how the process changes, only depends on the current time and the current position. There's no time dependence. That's just a space operator. Depends on the current position. So it's a Markov property. The future does not depend on the history, but only at the current. So if I plug in S of t here, I plug in a process here instead of a position. I plug in the current position, which is a stochastic, which is a random variable given by the stochastic process. Here, I plug in x of t here. Because the process x is Markov, this is just this expectation conditioned on filtration at time t. Filtration means the information up to time t. Okay. This f betting on the position that x is the domain, that's a fixed random variable. In a condition on the current information, because of the power property of conditional expectation, meaning that conditional expectation of conditional expectation is conditional expectation. So that's a martingale, because you take a further conditional expectation condition on a previous time, let's say f little s, that will pop out u x of s. So there's a martingale. So martingale, it shouldn't have any drift. It only has this diffusion time depends on the Brownian motion. So when you use Eaton's formula again, you will have, okay, now you will have gradient of u as t, est, and then plus second order term, which is here, a little bit careful. Second order term times the second order, the cross term, and summing all the indexes. And if you do a little bit of algebra, this, it has a time component. That's all the time component. It's given by B. So it's B times gradient of U. And then there's just some like diffusion term, which is given by Brownian motion. Okay. This cross term, it does not have any diffusion term, Brownian motion. It only has the first order term of the time. Because, okay, dt times dt does t squared. We just throw that away because that's too small. And dt times dwt, that's the pre-halves. Order of t raised to the power of pre-halves, which we throw that away. So it only has this dwt times dwt. Only has this. Which we will keep is the first order term of time. So here we will have summation, all the indices, and then the second order derivative of u times the sigma ik times sigma jk. Maybe I should call this ik jk. You have this, and then you are summing over all the indexes ijk. But if we look at this first, features, the collapse all the case. That's just the entry of the matrix capital A I K. So however ugly this is, the drift term is actually the elliptic operator L acting on function. L U. That's our drift, which is the first order term of time, which is the dt term. But we said that this process is Martingale, so this one better vanish. So L of u is equal to 0. So I think I have convinced you that your conjecture makes sense. Is that the solution to this PDE is given by an integral with respect to a transition probability. You start at x, and then you access the domain at position 1, which is a probability density. And the process is given by this stochastic differential equation with a drift B and a diffusion function. The reason for G is that PDE Galois calls it Green's function. G set. But it's actually a probability density. By the way, this is called the Feynman-Kac formula for elliptic PDEs. It says that, okay, solution to differential equations, and then V verifies the PDE. Solutions to differential equations is given by expectations of a functional of a stochastic process. And vice versa. And let me give you one more example before I move on to something non-stochastic, which is the method of characteristic. So I was putting like this little t's here when I was writing my elliptic equations. So I was wrong, because elliptic equation it only has a space variable, it does not have a time variable. And now let's put the time variable back. Let's assume that we don't have a steady state. We have an extra term time, so u depends on the time and the space as well. So it changes as time flows. And this is called a parabolic equation. Because this is like it's a second order of this is the first order operator. And a parabolic is given by this. So second order, first order. So that's why it's called a parabolic equation. So let me give you the Feynman-Kac for parabolic equations. And then we'll move on to methods of characteristics. So now I claim that solutions to this equation is given by, again, an expectation of a stochastic. So now let's look at that we have a terminal condition. Now I don't want to talk about boundaries anymore, so let's claim that if I define from my BTS like this, then BTS will solve this equation.
Yes. Wait, so you're just cutting off the process at some given time?
Yes. So, well, I'm not. Let's say it this way. You have, you're given this fixed time first, and then you produce a process.
Okay.
The process is like, depending on the PDE. So you're given the PDE first, and then you cook up a process. Yes. Usually this is coming from like social science. It's really non-physical. So let's say this capital T is the time of your graduation. And let's say UTX is something like, depending on your level of, I don't know, working, this is like the normal paper or whatever, the salary that you get, right, at the time of graduation. And you want to somehow like optimize, let's say, your salary. And you have this PDE, it's the critical condition that you work to optimize your salary. So you have something, a goal that you aim for, which is the time is fixed. And then you generate your process, you generate your X, which is like, let's say the process of how hard you work. Something like that. Okay. So, again, the same idea. This X is a space variable is fixed, but let me plug in the process here, plug in the random variable. This guy, as a new process time, is going to be a martingale, because if you look at this process, still, it's Markov. The future does not depend on the history, but only the current position. So, V of T of X of T is a conditional expectation of a fixed random variable. And by the same principle of conditional expectation, conditional expectation is conditional expectation. This is a martingale. It's a martingale. MG stands for martingale. And then you compute this guy. Blah, blah, blah. But under the computation anymore, I think you believe that the drift term, which we set to zero, is given by left hand side of this PDE, a parabolic operator. Okay. So again, this V will verify the PDE, and this representation of a solution to a PDE given by expectation of a function acting on the process, let's call a Feynman-Kac. This is a Feynman-Kac formula for parabolic PDEs. If you believe that elliptic equations and parabolic equations are given by the solution can be given by a stochastic process. Is, and now I'm looking at something that's non-stochastic. And I will like draw an analogy between the non-stochastic version and this one. And we'll see like why I really introduced that. And then we'll move on to the Bevel stochastic differential equation. So, stochastic is a way of writing PDEs of first order. Into a system of ODEs. And then by solving the systems of ODEs, you can reproduce the solutions to the first order PDE. Okay. And why is that? Because ODEs are easy to solve. And second, it's quite physical. There's a meaning attached to ODEs, namely the flows. So ODEs is actually, you can think of it as a change of variable of space-time. By the way, the equations are just go down for the stochastic version, they're all linear because L operator is just a differential operator. And derivatives is linear. Here, I'm looking at something that's more advanced, it's nonlinear. And that's why we are taking this detour. If it were linear, then you can just do the techniques of integrating factors. So the PDE, first of all, the PDE I'm looking at is, let's say for example, there's a time dependence, dt of u plus f of t x u and gradient of u. This one is zero. And let's say for example, you're given the terminal condition. Again, let's say you try to optimize something at the time of at the target time. Let's give it about f to the left. I'm given this system of PDE and you try to solve it. Try to find a representation. So what you do is that the ODE is that you're looking for an ODE. Is that when you plug x in the position of x, z in the position of u, and t in the position of gradient of u, q in the position of the time derivative u, we want this to be true. We want the original PDE to be true. So what you want is that plug your the ODE you're looking for is that ODE satisfied by XZ get this equality. Looks like what a system of OE should be. Okay, but now when you take the derivative of P and Q, you're not so lucky. Because you'll get this cross term. Right? It's high order terms. Right? If you take derivatives of P and Q. Calculation because we don't need that. And it's bad. But because it's bad, so we don't need the calculation. Instead, we have another we have another equation that we haven't used, which is saying that the Q plus this whole F acting on the junks is zero. So we can take the derivative of that, which is also zero. Take the time derivative of Q, and then now by chain rule. Get something like this. Partial f of t plus f partial derivative of x times derivative of x plus partial f partial z times z derivative plus partial f partial p. Okay, so let me plug in z dot over there. So if I let my ODE to be this, I can set up my ODE to be x dot being partial F, partial P, C dot being this guy, Q times partial P times X dot is partial F, partial P. And set this to be 0. And also set this orange things to be 0. Then I get a closed system. Okay, you can actually determine if I'm given the initial condition. So I set this to 0, so P dot is going to be negative partial F partial X. Negative partial F partial Z times P. Q dot be negative partial and partial T minus partial F partial T plus Q. Now, this looks horrible, but look at the system. You can uniquely determine. On the left hand side is the derivative of this vector. On the right hand side is given by, you see a Q here, you see a P here, and then you see a P here, you see a Q here. Great, right? So that's actually a first order ODE, vectorial ODE, first order ODE in vectors, right? So if I choose the right initial conditions, I solve these ODEs, and I look at C of T in particular, that will give me the equation, that will give me the value of U of T of X. So what I'm saying is that if I want to know the value of UTX, I want the value of UTX first. We can solve an equation of this type with the appropriate initial condition. So let's call the solution with initial value times t is equal to x, that would be this guy. Have the ODE of this one, okay, and in particular, I can plug in the value capital T. This is going to be U acting on this guy. This is going to be F. Because of the boundary data, U capital T is going to have. But this, by definition, is going to be Z capital T. So now I solve the second one. With the terminal condition in particular, I plug in little t here. And the terminal condition, I plug in this guy. F x capital T x, this is capital. Okay. This expression is going to give me U little t times with the raw initial condition. That you'll be confused, so let me first draw a picture and then give an example. Just this. Which I'll explain what this ODE is actually doing. It's a change of coordinate. That's what ODE is doing. So, that's the space at.
This is just local, right?
Hmm?
It's just local, right?
Yes, it's local, or let's say if you want to extend global, you have to find some specific ways. So that's why it's called bullshit. It's like, it's a guess, it's an answer of the what the solution should look like. It never asserts that the solution exists, even exists. But the good thing is that if you know that solution exists, then it's unique, then it better be this guy. It cannot be anything. So it's guess of the form of the solution instead of like trying to prove that the solution actually exists. The PDE could be so imposed that you don't have a solution, or the solution is not unique. So this is a space at the terminal time. This is a space at some previous time. Okay, so we want to know the function ut of x here. Instead of looking at the coordinates given by the space, instead you use an ODE, use a flow. Go back to a terminal time, which is what the ODE of x is doing. It's like you look at a flow. Starting at px, and then you let it flow and goes back to, or goes back, goes forward to time capital T, to your terminal time. And now, because at the terminal time, you look the, you know the value of this function. And now that's your terminal condition of z. So you solve the ODE of z. Go back and tell you what the value of u, a little t should be. So that's what this ODE is doing. So instead of using the space coordinates here, you use the space coordinates given by this flow, which is, the PDE guys know this is called the Eulerian coordinates, and this is called the Lagrangian coordinates. And what the PDE is doing is that, let's look at the coordinates in Lagrangian sense instead of the Eulerian sense. So, that's what methods of characteristic is, and this system of ODE is called characteristic ODEs. So now it's time to give an example. Also, I never touched these two ODEs. They will be touched in general, but in linear case, you don't need this tool. it's the simplest F that you can get, it's linear. So a first ODE X, well, that's easy. Going on F with respect to P, that's just B. So my flow is actually a straight line. Straight line and goes back to the terminal time. And now let me look at Z. Z dot is going to be QT plus PT B dot P. But you know that there's something implicit. QT times F, I think on T, X of T, C of T, P of T, is zero. So QT plus B times PT plus C times ZT minus C times by zero. So in a linear case, you don't actually need the second and the third. Oh, sorry, you don't need the third and fourth ODEs. You only need the first two. You have a closed system that you can solve. Also, this is just an exponential, but C is a constant. So in particular, know the terminal value, you can just do something like this. C little d is given by this one. So F is a straight line, so thing is that to get the value of U T X should align back to T. Capital T, and then find what ZT is, which is F of X capital T. And then multiply by exponential. Get what you want. So here's something interesting. Suppose that this guy is not a straight line, but you add some noise. This is a straight line, right? But you add some noise. How about Brownian motion? Add some noise, right? Let's say C is zero. We don't have this exponential term. Well, now that you have some noise, your flow will not get you back to a fixed position, but some it's a random variable, right? So your best guess may be the expectation of all these things. So heuristically, what you should think is this guy starts at with this initial condition. Now there's some noise, we're going to take that out. Well, how about take the average heuristic? This is Feynman-Kac. This is just instead of being an ODE, it's an SDE, stochastic differential function. In the linear case. So actually, that's the connections here. So the interpretation of Feynman-Kac, I think, should really be this flow representation. So what is stochastic differential equation? What it does is actually floating the information, floating the coordinates with the terminal time, time space. And then, because there's noise, so the best you can do is like take the application. Which, by the way, is not in the test book. Well, the methods of characteristic, yes, that's in Abbott's or any other PDEs. Feynman-Kac, yes, that's in almost every stochastic calculus test books. But I didn't see like people connecting both of them, connecting the first order one and the second order. So now I think I convinced you that these two, they're actually the same. So Feynman-Kac is actually the elliptic version of methods of characteristics. And this diffusion, the stochastic differential equation, is actually the characteristic stochastic differential equations of this PDE. Because here, this depends on PDE. This
wait, if you add noise, that should be the second order. The PDE should be second
yeah,
order.
Yeah, that's a second order
okay,
today.
Yeah. Okay.
So there should be something like related to this.
Yeah.
So instead of putting a grad U here, possibly you should put in something like this instead. Okay, but that's just some heuristics, and let me finish a talk by introducing what a backward stochastic equation is. So let me go back to the case. Stochastic differential equations. So, what's the bad word? Stochastic differential equation. So, in the Feynman-Kac formula, we never explicitly write down what the z is. So let me write down what the z is. So x, let's say we still have this x. Given by this stochastic differential equation. Instead of writing explicitly the differential of u t x t, let's say we call this guy yt. We are thinking yt is u t x t. Okay. We do the computation. The dt term. Let me write down the diffusion term. Times gradient u times the differential of the drawing motion. And instead of calling this like b gradient u, let's call it c of t. Let me fill in the gap. Here you have a c of t. All the rest, no matter how ugly it is, that only depends on x. So we can write it, let's say, z of t plus just something depends on time and position of x. dt plus dt. And now suppose that we want to change this jump. You want this drift not only depends on x, but also depends on y side. And also depends on z. So we write down an equation. Like have your boundary, the terminal condition, y capital T is equal to u capital T s capital T. And that's given by x of t. So we know what the terminal condition is, but instead of letting it be a functional depending on x, we just let it to be reinterpret. So look at this equation. We have a terminal condition, and that's why it's called backward. And you have a stochastic equation, that's why it's a stochastic differential function. So this is what a stochastic, a backward stochastic differential function is. Okay. Why I'm looking at it? Because now suppose that this like is formally a differential equation makes sense. Suppose that I can do calculus on this one. I'm claiming that y of t with x of t elliptic x. This process is going to solve call this real function of the vtx. This is defined vt of x in this way. Vt of x is going to solve a nonlinear second order differential equation instead of a linear second order differential equation. So what the equation is, still have something as usual, a differential operator, a parabolic differential operator. But now you have this equation. G, T, X, U. What should I put in the place of Z is actually sigma grad U. With the terminal condition U capital T is not F. Why you should solve this nonlinear equation? The nonlinearity comes from this. So risky because if you plug in V, T, you plug in the random variable, plug in the process X of T. This is yt, right? This is yt, but with x, the initial condition, xt being x. So, look at this differential equation, you integrate it. What you will get is, of course, you don't start from zero, start from the terminal condition t. Because you know this guy. Side is going to be from little t to capital T, G, S, 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 Y, S, Z, S, D, S, plus a diffusion term which is going to be Martingale. And now if you take conditional expectations of T, this is a Martingale that will vanish. So move is negative g to the left, because that's why I put it in negative. So yt, which you think is vtxt, is not a modulo. The plus is external integration term. That's going to be modulo. From 0 to t, g, ds. Plus this g term, that's going to be modulo. And that's where this guy, this nonlinear term, is coming from. It's coming from this integration. So do the same thing. We take the differential of this guy, we have a parabolic operator here. In the differential of this integration, you have this extra g term here. And this entire thing is going to be a new g and set to 0. Because that's a modulo. So we get this nonlinear differential equation. The solution to the nonlinear differential equation is given by this convoluted construction. First, you flow x back to term capital T. And then look at the value y at the terminal time. And then we try to solve this backward stochastic equation for time little t. And that gives you the value of the PDE. Okay. So the last thing, which is going to be rigorous, is how to make sense of this integration. This differential equation. Because that's just something that's formal. It's not a valid mathematical construction. So what's the solution? And does it exist or not? Can you see it? Okay, here's things becoming technical. So I want several conditions. First, I want the terminal condition, the terminal random variable, to be squared. And why is that? Because I only want to study Hilbert space for laziness. That's one thing. Okay, in order to be square integrable, all of my integration, it better be square integrable. I want this guy, and I also want square of the drift term to be square. So solution is a pair YZ such that these two integrability inequality satisfies, and also Y and Z, they are adapted. So Y is given by differential equation, so Y is continuous. And also, differential equation is actually an integral equation. So basically, I'm rewriting this integral equation again, such that this one holds, this equality holds, almost surely. Integrate that equation and then rearrange some terms. Okay. That's what a solution means. This is obvious. What's not obvious is that we really want this square integrability. In order to have uniqueness. Think about it. Actually, like parabolic equations, the solution to parabolic equations not unique unless you look at some nice functions. Yes.
Okay, maybe this is stupid, but where do you, so does, given y and z a solution, do you get x back? Or do you need to
you assume that you know x.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Well, here now you can just suppress x, let's say you can suppress x and let's say g. Instead of mapping from time x so we can think of g as random, then suppress it. Yes. And the thing is that this allows more general dynamics. Dynamics may not be generated by, the randomness may not come from x here. May not come from the diffusion, the stochastic flow. So the integrability is not something observed if you think about parabolic equation. Actually, parabolic equation, its solution is not unique unless you restrict the parabolic equation is bounded by some BSDE exponential functions. Now here's a theorem which will look familiar to PDE analysis, because the first statement you look at it, you will like know what to do to prove. Suppose that G is uniformly ellipsis. So uniform means that the ellipsis constant does not depend on time. Assume that your terminal condition, the terminal random variable, is great. And in particular, if you plug in zeros out there into your yz, the position of y and z, look at the square integral. Seems to be finite. And BSDE has a which is great. Lipschitz condition. Why do we want to do that? So let me sketch the proof a little bit. Basically, I won't do the calculations, but you know what to do. So step one is just to define a map given U and V. So U is in position of Y, V is in position of Z. Define map phi by what? So U in the position of Y, V in the position of Z on the left hand side, and the output on the right hand side is this guy. That's your output. So given U and V, plug in the G, and what you produce on the right hand side is Y and Z. Okay, Y is easy to produce by just taking conditional expectations, because this guy is a martingale. It vanishes. So if you take conditional expectation, you get Y. So how do you cook up Z? Well, that's because of the martingale representation. And also because why this L2 is handy is you have a Hilbert space isometry of the terminal value. So what I'm talking about is that that's a Hilbert space that's isometric to this is a Hilbert space of the integrand. And this is a Hilbert space of the integral. So it says that this map is a Hilbert space of isometry. So once you know U and V, you integrate from 0 to capital T, that gives you a random variable. And because of the isometry, which is abstract nonsense, you get an integrand automatically. And you need integrand. So you have this map that's well defined. So step one, you define such a map. And step two, because G is uniform Lipschitz, you play some little game. You use Sparner construction. Prove that phi is a Sparner conjunction under some certain norms. Then the fixed point theorem tells that it's in the exponential. That's why we're imposing this Lipschitz condition. Of course, if you're going to relax this condition, sometimes you're going to choose, sometimes it's not. It's not here. Is there any questions?
So that's sharp condition.
It's not sharp. What I'm saying, so if you can that's just for the proof to go. This is always going to be true if G is uniform Lipschitz. If G is not Lipschitz, okay, there's a case that we know there's never going to have a solution, which is that if G is super quadratic, three super quadratics, something like this. Yeah, we can show that in general, it's not going to be a solution. So existence fails. If G is quadratic, it's kind of complicated. It's something not very old. But this is well known because it's using the classical tool. I think like my intention of this law is to suppress these technical details, but just to give you the connections between differential equations and stochastic calculus. Yes.
Can you do more? Yeah, so just in general, can you do more by doing it more difficult or in using more processes at the same time? Can you do something even more complicated than, say, second order G, which is second order? So the relation to G of the BSDE to the PDE is that G is second order in this case.
You mean the differential equation?
Yeah, the differential equation is second order.
Okay. To be honest, I don't know.
I don't think you can do it because Brownian motion only corresponds to second order PDE, right?
Yeah, that's one thing. But I'm not sure if there's some other fancy calculus.
So I was thinking that you couldn't do more than second order by Brownian motion, but then you're introducing all these new you're introducing more processes. Like you're doing pairs of processes, or if you take more processes, can you?
Okay, I got what you're saying. So the thing is that now I have like X and Y, right? Let's say if I add another processes, let's say, write down another differential equation, it's called Z. It won't increase the order because it's still a Brownian motion case, so it's still a second order PDE. However, if you get you to a more equation, because the PDE are just low down. Something that involves here. So if you add something more, you have something like this. But you have to have two backward stochastic differential equations, which they call it two BSDE. So it's called second order backward stochastic. Because here now the dynamics of grad u depends on this command. So you have to write down a backward stochastic differential equation from u, you have to write down another backward stochastic differential equation for grad u.
So the first thing is not fully nonlinear. That's just quasi linear or something.
This one?
Yeah.
Yeah, this one is semi linear.
Yeah.
Because the highest term is still linear. But if I'm talking about, I don't know. But the thing is that by throwing more processes, we increase the nonlinearity of the equation. Just, it's the same thing as the first order methods of characteristics. For the linear case, we only need these two. If f is not linear, then you have to Q dot and P dot. That one is not. At least there's a form, there's a representation of that. That one is not. The higher order. Other questions?
So there's a proof involved BDG.
Yes, clever. Just say it was BDG. The point is that it's two things. It's how do you cook up Z? It's because of this isology of Martingale.